with your KLEK 1 to 2.5 forecast. Low pressure, a storm system coming in for the southwest around New Mexico, western Texas, will be giving us clouds, rain showers, not just today and tonight, but Friday as well. Could be a thunderstorm. And the high temperature will be in the mid-60s this afternoon, 45 to 50 tonight. And those temperatures will be falling from the 50s down into the 40s Friday. But the good news is everything clears out for the weekend. Jonesboro, that's your KLEK 1 to 2.5 FM weather.
From Feature Story News in London, I'm Natalie Powell. Ex-White House aide Fiona Hill has told the impeachment inquiry into US President Donald Trump that Mr. Trump pressed Ukraine to investigate rival Joe Biden. The Athletics Integrity Unit has suspended a number of Russian athletics officials, including the president of the country's athletics federation. And India is playing its first day-to-night cricket match at Eden Gardens in Kolkata.
It's 9:01.
KLEK LP Jonesboro, the voice of Arkansas Minority Advocacy Council. It's now time for Community Conversations, a program focusing on the people working to make the Jonesboro community a better place while offering viewpoints from all sides of the issues. The views expressed in this program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of KLEK 102.5 FM, the voice of Arkansas Minority Advocacy Council, or our underwriters or sponsors.
Good morning, everyone, and happy Friday to you. I hope that you're having a great start to your rainy day here in Arkansas. You're tuned in to Community Conversations on KLEK 102.5 FM. My special guest today is the one and only Reverend Dr. Greg Ota.
Good morning.
Good morning. So today he's going to be talking about the New Life Empowerment Development Center, which is the computer lab, among many other things. Talking about the computer services and classes that he has to offer. So let's start out by telling them where you are located.
We are at 601 Marshall Street. It's on the corner of Belt and Marshall. It's over there where the housing authority have houses. It's a busy corner. There's a playground attached to it. That's where we are, 601 Marshall Street.
All right, so if you have any need to learn any program, even if it's for personal or for professional, please go and see Reverend Ota. He will be happy to take care of you. Of course, you have a schedule. So can you tell everyone your hours of operation?
Well, usually I walk by appointment.
Okay.
But on a regular day, like now, I should have been at the lab. I'm usually there doing something. So the adults in the neighborhood.
Okay.
Some come to fax, some print something, or just check their email. So I'm there from 8 o'clock till about noon. Then I take a little break sometimes, and I'll be back in the lab at about 1:30, 2 o'clock. The kids don't get out of school till about 3:10.
Okay.
So I'm usually already there by the time they get there.
Okay.
And we close at 5, but most times I let them go home at 4:30 because it's getting a little darker now.
Yes.
Because they all have to walk home.
Okay.
Some of them have to cross Belt Street, which can be busy sometimes.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
All right, so let's just get into some of the types of programs that you teach. Let's start with the youngest age group. Like, what do you
teach? I take them, for right now, I need volunteers.
Okay.
So I can only take from 7 years upwards.
Okay.
Because those can take instructions and you can give them some work to do by themselves. The other ones, nose is still running and they need personal attention, and sometimes I don't have it because I have 10 computer stations in that lab.
Okay.
And everyone that is on the computer needs to be monitored. Sometimes I let them play games, mindless games. It's not really mindless. Some of them are devilish. So I have to be able to monitor them.
Okay.
Otherwise, most of the games we let them play are educational as well.
Okay.
There's Cool Math for kids. There's all e-learning. There's all kinds of stuff on the computer, on the internet, that is free.
Okay.
That we let them get on.
Okay.
But then there's a game they play. It's called Roblox.
Roblox.
Yeah. Well, sometimes there's killing. There's all kinds of stuff involved in it. So depend on who's playing and who's monitoring. So when you have 10 kids, it's hard to monitor each individual. Mm-hmm. Some of them are slick, you know.
Yes,
you look away and they're somewhere they're not supposed to be. So we have a lot of educational games we let them get into. But our primary purpose of being in that corner is to replicate the services at the library.
Okay.
Not necessarily fully, but particularly access to the computer and the internet. For the thing, some kids who are in high school who don't have a computer at home, they come to the lab to do their homework. So you need internet there.
Okay.
Some of the kids, some of our kids, are not up to par in their grade. And the lab will help them with their homework.
Okay.
We have a subscription to education.com that follows the grades of the children. So they put educational programs on site. If you are a subscriber, you could download, you could print, you can have the kids go online to do these exercises.
Okay.
So those are some of the things we do.
Have you, I don't know if you've contacted like A State and to talk to their education department to see if some of the students would be able or willing to intern to serve as.
Well, I need help, Ms. Kubila.
I think that would be... For those that are interested in early education, early childhood education.
Yes, because we have ample opportunity for people like that to internship or whatever.
We'll definitely have to get you connected to someone.
Please
from the education
I need
department.
Help. Help me.
And if anyone else out there that's listening, good morning, Ms. Rebecca, Laura Evans, thank you for checking in. Anyone else out there, if you would love to intern, volunteer, if you have a love, a desire for working with children, please contact Reverend Greg Ota. He will be happy to get you set up and get you on the way. He definitely needs some extra hands in
the
lab.
And here's the interesting part too. It's not a volunteer for a whole day. If I could get somebody in there from 3 to 4,
okay,
to help me, because that's when the activity is most.
Okay.
Between 3 and 4. That's when all the kids show up. That's when I need help.
So 1 hour a day.
1 hour a day.
All right.
1 hour a day. You don't have to sweep if you don't want to. You don't have to do anything. The kids actually right now, they help me clean up the lab.
Okay.
Yep. There are some kids, very nice kids. They come, they say, Dr. Oda, do you need any help? I say, yeah, could you sweep the floor? They do.
Awesome. All
right. They don't ask to get paid or anything. We give them some candy.
I give fruit and vegetables. All right, so that's the younger age group. So with the more intermediate group, the 7 and up, they're learning coding, which is very, very important because nowadays most everything is going digital, going, you know.
Yes, everything is going computer.
And so someone has to know how to program, and a code is basically the directions you give a
computer. So they say garbage in, garbage out. In my undergraduate, that's beyond your age. In my undergraduate classes, we took basic computer algorithm.
Okay.
Where we had to learn, I want this result, but how do I tell the computer to give me this result based on what I put in it?
Okay.
So you code backwards.
Okay.
So what we had to learn is, in fine arts also, on the computer, that's what is called pixels.
Okay.
That's what makes up a picture. So what do I tell each pixel to do?
Wow.
To get a picture of Kubila's face. So what is the hue for the pixel that is at the center of your nose?
Ooh.
So I have to know how to code it so it will give me the right answer.
Wow.
That's what coding is.
Okay.
Now, it's a little bit more advanced now because the kids... They are coding games and all kinds of educational programs. The same principle. But if you don't understand what the result needs to be, you can't code it correctly.
Wow.
So it's like in a class, a teacher is teaching algebra. You have no idea what they said. So you ask a question. But if you don't ask the right question, you will get the right answer. How do we arrive at the result? Well, you saw me do the math and then here, what do you mean? I want to know how we got to first one, or second base, or third base. So it's the same thing with a computer. Remember this, computer is there to serve you, but you have to tell it how to serve you. Okay. If you don't know what you want, it can't give you what you want. It cannot.
Okay.
You have to tell it what you want for it to be able to give you what you want.
All right, so that's coding in a nutshell, but it, it gets so much more intense once you're in class and once you get to know more of the steps and learn the language of coding, because, you know, it's more than just zeros and ones and dots and dashes and all that. It's a whole
You have to know where to put the ones and the zeros.
All right, so you offer coding, and I know over the summer you offered some, you had an extensive list of activities that were week by week, what the students would be learning. So during the fall and winter, I know that school has a lot of, some bigger breaks, like the fall break is coming up for Thanksgiving next week and the Christmas break. But do you offer any other type of fall, winter, like lineup of programs?
No, what, because of the location where we are, we have very high turnover.
Okay.
Most students we start a class with, we don't end with.
Okay.
So they break and leave in the middle. Not because of what we're doing.
Okay.
But because of their home situation.
Okay.
Some pack up and leave in the middle of the semester and relocate. So you can't continue with the same student. So what we do is we customize our programs to just keep them afloat in school. We don't teach an extended type of class because you might not be able to sustain it. Okay, let me give you an example. I could start a young student on Excel. He doesn't need it now.
Okay.
He or she doesn't need it now. Maybe in the second week, well, mom is sick. They didn't go to school. They didn't come to the lab. For the next 3 weeks, you don't see them. But the rest are coming. What do you do now when the kid comes back? So you have to juggle all this. And since I don't have enough volunteers, I'm the only one doing it.
Okay.
It's easy to drop that student and just go on. So rather than drop them, let's not get started. Let's deal with the areas where you are having issues at school.
Okay.
So you can keep up with schoolwork. So we do their homework with them. We teach them reading and comprehension. Which is one of the hardest things that I had to learn the hard way. If you want to teach a kid coding and you write the instructions down, if he can't read it, he's not going to code anything.
Okay.
So we're teaching them to read and comprehend what they have read and to follow the instructions.
Okay, and that's a whole other.
Yeah,
it's a whole other lesson.
But it's exciting for me though.
Are you learning, or are you, I guess, witnessing, kids are becoming more reliant on computers and technology versus actual, but like they're listening to things more versus reading more. And so are you trying to find a way to bridge the gap between, okay, you still have to learn how to read text on paper versus allowing the computer to just read everything to you?
Well, what we've done, with all our computers have headphones now.
Okay.
We don't allow the computers to read to them.
Okay.
They have to read themselves. They have to pick up an actual book before they can get on the computer.
Okay.
And what I've done with most of them, especially the ones I know are struggling to read, I let them read by themselves, and I stop and I let them read to me what they have read. The older ones, I let them read on their own, and I need them to tell me what they've read. Don't read from the book. Tell me what you read. So we do this for comprehension. I want to know that you know what you read. And sometimes I ask them, what names were in the story you read? What's the purpose of the story? Well, they found the boat and they ended up in the sea and the octopus saved them. What are their names? So it makes them think back to what they saw, what they read. It's not, the whole idea is for them to remember what they read.
Okay.
Because if you don't remember what you read, it doesn't do you any good.
Yeah.
It's like reading the Bible. You don't remember what you read, it can't affect your life.
Yes, sir. Most definitely. All right, so the kids are learning coding, reading comprehension. And then, okay, moving up to high school and adult. Do you ever have high school students?
I do. But most times they just come in there to do their homework. So I don't mess with them too much. Yeah, most times they already know what they want to do and how they're going to do it. If it's their homework, I don't mess with them. They go to Google Classroom, okay, and they do their work.
Okay. Now, you know, the library, mm-hmm, Craig County Library, has a database where students can gain access to some educational software.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, for high school students who are considering the ACT, SAT, and other, you know, placement exams, even for college, mm-hmm, students. So, mm-hmm, do you encourage your kids to get a library card because they can access the database from any computer?
Well, I now that you've told me, I will.
Okay.
Now that you've told me, I will. Because we need every resource that's available. See, I was raised in Nigeria.
Okay.
We don't have access to a lot of things that these kids have here. So the more they know what's available, the better for them.
Okay.
I wish some of the things that we have here I could take home. I really do.
Well, if I had the money to pack up and leave, I would definitely try to help start the program. That's been one of my passions, to help take social programs, not just social programs, but resources to help, you, mm-hmm, know, people that are living in certain areas where it's not as abundant.
Amen.
But anyway, moving on. So, encourage your kids to get library cards. Maybe, mm-hmm, make that, you know, one of their goals and requirements. And, I don't know, start some type of incentive program with them.
And I'm interrupting you, I know. But you just gave me a thought.
Okay.
Since we don't have those resources at the lab, maybe we could partner with someone who has a van, a church or something. And we can encourage the high school kids whose parents don't have cars. Maybe once a week, we could take them over to the library to do some things we can't help them do at the lab. And we'll just go to the library and do that instead.
And there's a jet. I don't think our city bus gets utilized enough. Mm-hmm. There's a special price for, for students. So.
Oh, really?
And then the bus stops somewhere right around the library.
There's a bus stop right in front of the lab, as well.
So, we'll work on that.
Okay, let's work on that.
For next semester, get the kids to sign an agreement saying that I will do this, and this.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and then this is the
reward. That's awesome. That'd be... that'd
a reward program, but something, you know, that's beneficial to them.
Mm-hmm. I like that.
Work toward, you know, with these kids nowadays, they kind of... You shouldn't have to dangle a carrot in front of them, but, mm-hmm, sometimes you have to dangle something.
Amen. Well, we dangle food right now at the lab. We dangle food. And we have two McDonald's in the city that donate food to us.
Okay.
I know for a fact there are kids who come to the lab just for the food.
Okay.
But in the process of waiting for the food, we impact them with something. They either read or do a little math, or you don't just come for food. You got to do some work for the food, but it's usually educational.
And I guarantee you, they might not tell you because kids don't often know how to really express their thoughts and feelings.
True.
But you're imparting something very valuable onto them that as they get older and when, mm-hmm, they become adults, they're going to reflect on that.
Actually, it's funny you should say that. I have some kids that we started this in 2015.
Okay.
This lab... We were in this location in July 2015.
Okay.
This is 2019. So we've been there a few years. There were kids that were 9 then.
Okay.
They no longer come to the lab, but they come by once in a while.
Okay.
Just to say hello.
That's awesome.
And to be thankful for what was put in their lives. One of the reasons why we're in that corner is gang. So by the lab being open, we take the kids off the streets and put them in a safe place. So one of them plays football now.
Oh, wow.
He's in high school. He comes by once in a while to say hello. never been in trouble. So we like such testimony.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Well, hopefully your services will continue for many more years to come, and you will see more success stories. You will hear more success stories of the children that have come through. And hopefully the parents, I can't say they don't know that it's there, but I hope that more and more people realize that you are there and start to send their kids there.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe stop in every now and then and see what you're doing and maybe spend some time. That could be another way for parents to spend time with their kids, is come and sit with them at the computer lab and see what they're actually
mm-hmm.
doing.
Some parents used to do that. I don't know. I'm not sure why they stopped. And one of the things scary about me is I was raised paramilitary, so I like order.
Okay.
Some of the kids can't take order, so they have problems with me. In other words, they mistake the lab to be their right.
Okay.
In other words, I could do what I want to do when I'm in here. Okay. That's where they have a problem with me.
So they haven't learned, or they don't respect discipline.
No.
Or an order. Okay.
No. Actually, I have a funny story.
Well, we got about 30 seconds to tell it.
Well, 30 seconds is long enough. I have a story where I put a child out of the lab because they were trying to grab food that wasn't theirs. I put them out.
Okay.
Their mother came back to say, "Who put my child out of the lab?" I said, "I did." Okay. "What's your problem?"
So you're going to leave it there?
I'm going to leave it there.
All right. Well, we're going to give money to you. Thank you for checking in to everyone else out there listening and watching. We're going to take a quick break and tune in to Community Conversations on KLEK 102.5. We'll be right back after these announcements.
You're listening to Community Conversations on KLEK 102.5 FM. We'll be right back.
Are you sure you can make medical decisions for your child? I'm Mark Merrill with today's Family Minute. Recently, a friend asked a small group of us that question. We all had unmarried adult children. She explained to us that if any of our children were incapacitated and needed someone to make healthcare decisions on their behalf and see their personal health information, a signed designation of healthcare surrogate was necessary. Without it, we did not have legal permission to make decisions or receive information regarding our grown children's medical lives. So I encourage you to learn more about the importance of having a document that names you as your adult child's designated healthcare surrogate. Just go to my blog at markmerrill.com. Remember, your family first.
Made possible by the Kappa Nu Omega chapter of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority, Incorporated, a nonprofit organization committed to service to all mankind. KNOMEGA1908.com.
Family Minute is brought to you by the Gears Foundation, a nonprofit organization providing students with assistance in their academic and career pursuits. Gears Foundation on Facebook, Gears_Inc. on Instagram, and the Gears Foundation at gmail.com.
Hi, I'm Matt Kenseth. You don't have to be a race car driver to know that life can be full of drama. Some of it you can't control, like mechanical issues, high winds, and rain delays. But there's some drama you can skip.
Skip the drama that comes with not having your high school diploma or equivalency. Find free adult education classes near you and finish your diploma. Visit finishyourdiploma.org. That's finishyourdiploma.org.
You just need to take that first step and find free classes near you and leave the drama for the racetrack.
Brought to you by the Dollar General Literacy Foundation and the Ed Council.
KLEK thanks C.J. Pepper and the staff of Life Strategies Counseling Incorporated for helping people through hard times in life, such as depression, family issues, stress, abuse, and more. They offer counseling and therapy for all ages, individuals, families, and groups. They are located at 1217 Stone Street. Phone number 1-866-972-1268 or online at lscihelp.com.
Meineke of Jonesboro is now Starks Auto Service, a full-service auto repair and vehicle maintenance center offering engine and transmission repair, brake service, tires, oil changes, and more, performed by ASE certified mechanics. Starks Auto Service, 2813 South Caraway Road in Jonesboro, 870-204-7112. Starks Auto Service, Jonesboro.com.
The Office of Diversity and Community Engagement at Arkansas State University, under the leadership of Dr. Maurice Gibson, is a proud supporter of KLEK and is dedicated to finding innovative ways to advance their mission of creating a diverse and inclusive environment conducive to educating, enhancing, and enriching lives, uplifting various and diverse groups on the A-State campus, and striving to maintain Arkansas State University, a place that is inclusive to all individuals, regardless of origin, color, religion, socioeconomic status, or sexual orientation. More information about the Arkansas State University Office of Diversity and Community Engagement is available at www.astate.edu/diversity and 870-972-3081.
Experience the joy with Bishop Adrian R. Rogers, pastor of Fullness of Joy Church, 2120 Thorn Street, Jonesboro, Arkansas, 72401. Wednesday night, Word and Worship, 7 p.m. Prayer Thursday night at 7 p.m. Sunday school, 9:30 a.m. Sunday morning worship, 11 o'clock a.m. And our Sunday night live service at 7 p.m.
And now back to Community Conversations on KLEK 102.5 FM.
Welcome back to Community Conversations on KLEK 102.5 FM with my special guest, Reverend Dr. Greg Ota from New Life Empowerment Development Centers. All right, and so I just want to read the tagline. It says, empowering individuals, families, communities, and nations. You really try to reach every person and every age group. You try to educate and empower them with knowledge. And it's not just about computers, but it's you give them some life lessons along the way.
Yes, because if you redeem a man and you don't redeem his economic situation, you haven't done anything. So if I teach you how to read, and you learn how to read, but you don't know how to act, you're still hindered. But if I teach you to read, and I teach you how to apply your knowledge, you can move ahead in life without offending. Okay. Knowledge is very powerful. The Bible says, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. So if you don't know how to act when you go to Nigeria, you're about to get in trouble. Okay, when I go to Nigeria and come back here and I don't know how to act when I'm back in the States, I'm about to get in trouble. I'm educated. But if I don't know the day-to-day applications of life here, I will always be in trouble. So that's what we try to do at the lab. Empower individuals, especially the kids. Correct them in what you know that's going to get them in trouble in the future, either with the law or with some authority. Because if I give you anything and you don't know how to say thank you, I'm not likely to give it to you again. As much as you think it's your right to get it, I'm not likely to give it to you.
Yes.
Okay.
And then you miss an opportunity to really learn something and grow from knowledge.
Some kids, when you give them something because it's not being taught at home, they just grab it and walk the other way. Now what happens, I make you come back and either say thank you or give me back what I gave you. Because I don't have to give it to you. So what I'm teaching in effect is nobody has to give you anything. No matter how much you think is your right, nobody has to give you anything.
Yes, sir.
If they have to give it, they don't have to give it to you. So if they decide to give it to you, the least they can do is come back and say thank you.
Yes.
So those are the life lessons we teach.
All right. And hopefully those lessons will carry those individuals, will stay with them and they carry it with them. And they realize they have to work hard. They have to be mindful of who they're around.
That's it.
Mindful of their actions. And I hope that they as they transition to each stage of their life, they really take what you're trying to teach them and apply it in every area of their life.
You know, when in this society today, I have a very nice car. It's not the best in the market, but it's the best for me.
Okay.
Now, I pay for that car. The roads are paved because of taxes and the government. Mm-hmm. For me to drive on this road, there is a law. Okay? That governs the roads.
Yeah.
Okay. If I take the car I pay for and put it on a public road, there's rules that I must obey to use the public road. If I stop obeying it, the law will come down on me. Okay. To me, because I don't want to obey, it will look and seem harsh to me because the cop pulled me over and stopped me from making my appointment. But I'm the one breaking the law.
That's right.
So I am responsible for how I handle the car that I own and the public road that I share with other people. See, it's where I'm going with this. If you don't teach people how to obey the law, they're about to violate the law. And if everybody is violating the law and breaking the law, we have a lawless society.
Right. And so with that, you try to, again, not only just teach kids computer skills, mm-hmm. you teach them other skills that will help them govern themselves in every aspect of their lives.
Yes.
And hopefully, also with the skills that you teach them, they will advance in their education, they will advance in their career of choice, mm-hmm. and it's never too early to get the children to start thinking about what they possibly want to do in life, mm-hmm. but it takes us as the adults Amen. To introduce them to a variety of topics and genres. We have to start them early. We already start giving baby, I've seen videos of babies not even 1 year old know how to operate a phone.
Oh yeah, I have a grandson that's two.
I mean, they know how to find what they want on YouTube. They know how yep. to find, you know, their kids' bop song, whatever they listen to. So why not turn it around and start educating them in a different way and mm-hmm. making sure they're getting access to the things that are going to be beneficial to them in life. Again, it's never too early.
No,
to never start too teaching early. Them. Some of the most intelligent people, they had people in their life when they were younger mm-hmm. that instead of, okay, going outside to play, they had to maybe spend an hour reading. Mm-hmm. They had to spend some time doing this, that, and whatever, mm-hmm. engaging in in-depth conversation about things. Mm-hmm. As a child, no, they don't always want to do that.
Yep. Well, a kid, even we adults, we don't want to read the Bible all the time, even though we know it's good for us. So, but for a child, they really don't have a goal. They just go to school because their parents insist on them and the government insists they go to school. But discipline can be taught. Mm-hmm. What I mean by discipline is not punishment, it's not, and I say this to the kids all the time. When we started this reading program, most kids you tell to read, they cry. So I started, look, reading is not punishment. I'm not trying to punish you. I'm trying to get you to read the words on the page. And then I need you to understand what you read, because some instructions I can't give you verbally. I might write it down. If you can't read, you won't follow instructions. You will always be stranded. So after a while, it became a custom in the lab. Reading is not punishment. So now some kids walk in, they go straight to the bookshelf to get a book to read. They know that's what I'm requiring of them.
Okay.
So you teach discipline. The reason why I'm sharing this story is before, they will come and I will insist on them reading. Now they come in, they say, what do you want me to do today? It wasn't like that before. They come in looking for a snack, can I have some candy? No, we don't beg around here. You do your work, we'll give you whatever you need. So now they come and say, what do you want me to do today?
Okay.
So we have an opportunity to put discipline in their life.
Okay.
So it becomes second nature. Can I share something else with you?
Yes, sir.
Because God is in everything we do. We pray with the kids. Some of them didn't know the Lord's Prayer before they came.
Okay.
Now they can recite it on their own.
That's awesome.
You got to pray before you eat.
Okay.
Okay, the food is not free. It costs the board members that I have, they put money in what I do. Okay. United will put money in what we do. Not a lot of money, but it's enough to make sure the kids get fed.
Okay.
So before, for you to eat that food, it came from somewhere. You got to be thankful.
That's right.
All right.
All right. So again, the children are getting more than just computer education at the computer lab. But the computer skills that you're teaching will also help to elevate them in every aspect of their life. As they get, especially for the ones that are elementary school now, as they transition into junior high, high school, I can't even imagine what the technology is going to be like when they get there. And, you know, everything I'm pretty sure would be more digital. In one of my college classes, we're learning that the wave of education is going to be more online.
It's going to be more online.
There may, of course, there will be still some in-class discussion time, but as far as submitting assignments, reading, like right now I'm in grad school, all of my textbooks and materials are online. I don't have any physical books to read, so if it wasn't for a computer and the internet and learning how to navigate the student portal, I would be lost.
Key. Navigate.
Yes.
Because if you can't read, you can't follow direction.
Yeah.
Okay. That's one of my advanced degrees was online, completely online.
Okay.
Never saw a person. It's completely online. If I want to learn it, it's online. So that's where these things are going. And I'm talking to the PhD level.
Yes.
Everything is online. You write your dissertation, you send it in, they reply by email. They have questions, they reply by email, and you reply by email. So that's where we're going with this thing. A-State has a lot of online classes. You're taking some of them.
Yes.
So can you imagine 10 years from now what technology would look like in the classroom?
Children might not even have to go to a school building.
Okay.
They're logging on a computer at home at 8 o'clock in the morning, and there's a virtual teacher. She could be across the world. These kids are
in their home. It's happening now. The high school I went to in Nigeria, we created a computer lab over there.
Okay.
And we'll put, because electricity is unstable there, we'll put solar power enough to power the computers.
That's amazing.
We could speak to the students from here. Thousands of miles away.
Wow.
So that's what technology, that's where we're going with technology. But if you don't know the first step, you can't go to the second, third, and it's getting better every day. So if you don't learn the basics now, how are you going to survive?
So I hope the children that come to the computer lab are really taking heed to everything that you're trying to teach them, and they appreciate the lessons. And again, learn how to discipline.
Discipline.
Govern themselves.
Discipline is number one. Even if you're trying to read by yourself, you have to have a discipline to pick up the book. That's all we're trying to do. Encourage them to read. Get new information. Every day get new information.
So we hope that their parents will eventually start, you know, becoming more present and coming by to see what you're doing and interact with you and just have a conversation with you. And it's okay, what is my child working on? Where are they lacking? And again, this goes back to you having enough volunteers. We can't say that enough. You need extra
volunteers. I need help.
It would be wonderful if you had enough volunteers where each person had
a tutor.
Foul.
Yes.
They kept a foul on each child, and they were able to monitor their child's growth and progress while coming to the computer lab.
Yep. It's loose, too. It's not that strict. A volunteer, I could take a kid that they're interested in, find out what the kid needs, find out what we have to offer the kid. You just administer it.
Okay. Have you ever considered partnering with other organizations? Like, I know the kids are not necessarily seeking therapy, so life strategies and things like that may not be the type of caseworkers or individuals, but some other early education, again, to reach out to Arkansas State University.
Let's do that.
They have a lot of resources available, and they're always trying to bridge the gap in the community and partner with agencies to help the students gain more insight and understanding of what field they're going to be going into. So this would be a great project.
Well, right now, we we were partners with Family Ties. They're currently reorganizing. So there's a they have a mentoring program and on and on. They used to feed us as part of them, but they're reorganizing right now. And as soon as they come back, we'll reattach ourselves to them. We'll try to create other synergies in the city for people who are doing similar things and see how we can help them and see how they can help us. But we need help to do that because we don't know what everybody else is doing. But then this is, let me share this. There's a platform that CRDC and United Way has partners to bring to not-for-profits in the city.
Okay.
It's a shared database. Okay. Let's say you come to me at the lab and say, well, I'm in my master's program. I'm wondering if there's anybody, any non-for-profit organization there who can give me or who could loan me a computer. I put it on this platform. Maybe United Way or CRDC or somebody else, or at the dark or some program in the city said, yeah, we got a laptop we could give up for our education. Problem solved. Okay. Instead of me spinning my wheel, trying to do something I don't do, I put you on there and somebody else will pick it up and say, hey, we do that. What can happen with that? I've saw a request where somebody just got out of prison. They needed shoes and clothes and all that stuff. It was put on there. Somebody picked it up.
So a resource database.
Yeah, resource database.
Basically.
I can't even think of what it's called right now.
Okay. Well, we'll definitely have to get that information and put that out. And then I want to put this out for anyone that has a mentoring program or you work with children of any age. Contact Reverend Greg Ota and get to know what he needs or how you can possibly help him with the students that come there. Sometimes having a buddy to sit with them 30 minutes.
That's it.
If you can't do a full hour, that'd be great.
If you can do for an hour, that'd be great. If you say half hour, we'll take it.
Okay.
Our kids need positive role models.
Yes.
I don't care what you're doing. If you're standing on your 2 feet, you can lead somebody. You can influence someone.
And then we know that the area that the lab is located, it is majority, minority individuals. And
low income too.
We need, the children need someone that looks like them, that talks like them, that can still help to elevate them and help them grow mentally and spiritually. So the young men, they need men.
They need men.
To work with them.
Yes.
There's only so much a woman can do.
Yes.
And
there's a limit.
And I'm a mother of a son, so I'm speaking from experience. There's only so much a woman can do and impart on a young man. There will be people that will argue with me and say otherwise, but I'm telling you what I know.
Now, I'm going to get in trouble for this.
This is safe space.
God took woman out of man. But from then on, every man came out of a woman. So there's an extent, there's a limit to where a mother could take a son. Then a man has to take over. Because a woman has never been a man. He was taken out of a man. So everything in man is not in a woman. There are things left in a man that's not in a woman. So the woman is authorized to bear the child and raise him up to some extent. The man needs to take over to show a man what he's supposed to look like.
All right. So, again, we need all you males out there that have a little extra time, or you know someone that has extra time that can give to the children. And then if there are churches that have vans, bring your children over to the computer lab, you know, once or twice a week. And sit with them, you know, let them have this time. Help them learn these extra skills.
Yes, it is very helpful.
Computer skills are, again, we talked about this before, they're going to be necessary and vital in the future. And we could be talking a 3-year future, a 5-year future, or a 10-year future. We don't know. The way things are quickly changing, we just don't know.
We just don't know. We didn't think there was a time where a phone has no buttons. And you could dial on it.
Okay.
We couldn't think of it. Now every phone has a flat face.
Yes.
You don't hardly find buttons on the phone anymore.
I mean, only to power, or some phones, I don't know if they have a physical power button anymore. Like, they're changing so much.
Now, we didn't have to have Bluetooth. Now there's no wire.
Whole new concept.
Okay, so we're going from level to level. It's changing every day. So if I don't learn it today, where am I going to be tomorrow?
Yeah.
So that's what we're trying to get our kids to see where we're going with this thing.
Alrighty, so again, go see Reverend Greg Oates at the lab. So those who may have missed it, go ahead and give them the location. And
yep, 601 Marshall Street on the corner of Belt and Marshall. We have a website also.
Okay.
NLEDC.org. New Life Empowerment Development Center.org. Okay. Just the letters. NLEDC.org. Has a lot of information on it. Brother Brandon Tabo helps us with it.
Uh-huh.
Yep. We have a Facebook presence also.
Okay.
I have a Facebook presence also, NLEDC. You can find out a lot of information about us.
So please reach out and consider volunteering, mentoring, start a partnership of any kind.
Yep.
All help is needed and welcome.
All help is needed. You could just sit with a kid who's doing their homework. Even if you don't know the subject, just sit and encourage them. Maybe some people, I have some kids now. This is my opportunity to say this. I have kids, second grade. I have about five of them that come.
Okay.
Two of them don't read very well. All they need is a partner to sit there and tell them how to pronounce some words. That's all.
Okay. All right, so we're going to have to put a pause right there. When we come back, we'll wrap up our discussion with Reverend Greg Oster from the New Life Empowerment Development Center. All right, stay tuned. We'll be right back.
You're listening to Community Conversations on KLEK 102.5 FM. We'll be right back.
We're back with Money Matters. I'm Alfred Edmond Jr. Here's what you need to know about phishing and how to protect yourself. Phishing is a scam typically carried out with the help of unsolicited email or a fake website that poses as a legit site to lure in potential victims and then prompt them to provide valuable personal and financial information. Armed with this information, a crook can commit identity theft or financial theft. If you received an unsolicited email that appears to be from either the IRS or an organization closely linked to the IRS, report it by sending it to phishing@irs.gov. It is important to keep in mind that the IRS does not initiate contact with taxpayers via email, phone, text, or social media to request personal and financial information. I'm Alfred Edmond Jr. for Money Matters, a product of American Urban Radio Networks.
Money Matters is made possible by the Jonesboro Alumni Chapter of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority, Incorporated, a nonprofit organization focused on joy in our sisterhood, power in our voice, and service in our hearts. www.jonesboroalumnidst.org.
Money Matters is brought to you by the Gears Foundation, a nonprofit organization providing students with assistance in their academic and career pursuits. Gears Foundation on Facebook, Gears_Inc. on Instagram, and the Gears Foundation@gmail.com.
Money Matters is brought to you by Bancorp South, offering checking, savings, loans, credit cards, and wealth management. www.bancorpsouth.com or 870-972-9800.
Support for KLEK is brought to you by
the Essence Event Center in association with Mighty Morning Entertainment. Welcome to Live with Bobby Rush at the Essence Event Center, Saturday, November 30th. Doors open at 7 p.m. Bobby Rush, Saturday, November 30th at the Essence Event Center, 2044 East State Highway 18.
Ticket and other information is available at Prunty Bail Bonding, 870-935-6976, or Prunty Barbershop, 870-316-3157.
KLEK 102.5 FM salutes small businesses. Small businesses
promote local character and success, keeping money in the local economy, local jobs, entrepreneurship, community well-being, and so much more. Contact us today to learn more on how your small business could be featured on KLEK for as little as $25 per month.
Shout out to Letch's Barbecue Smokehouse, 1025 West Johnson Avenue, Jonesboro. Open Wednesday through Friday, 11 to 2 and 5 to 8, and Saturday, 1 to 5, 870-931-3310, Letch's Barbecue Smokehouse on Facebook.
Shout out to Letitia Fox Rochelle and Foxy's Fabulous Accessories, an independent paparazzi jewelry consultant. FoxySKB.com, Foxy's Fabulous Accessories on Facebook, or 870-761-4323.
And now back to Community Conversations on KLEK 102.5 FM.
Welcome back to Community Conversations on KLEK 102.5 FM with my special guest, Reverend Dr. Greg Ota from the New Life Empowerment Development Centers. He runs the computer lab on Marshall Street.
601 Marshall.
In Jonesboro, Arkansas. And he helps to empower, educate, and everything in between young minds on all things computer and life skills. We have to say life skills because you're not just sitting them down at a computer saying, here, type this in, learn this program, do this task. There, you're also engaging with them in other types of conversation, and you're teaching them along the way of why this lesson is important at right. this stage in your life. And
right. There's for lack of volunteers, what I do most times, there's a lot of programs online.
Okay.
That is self-monitoring. There's one called NitroType, which forces them. There are some of them who score low on key coding.
Okay.
Okay. So that is basically typing.
Okay.
So in order to put them on something that will force them to type, they like games.
Okay.
NitroType is a race game. On the bottom, it types sentences.
Oh.
And you follow the sentences by typing with a space. The better you type, the more accurate you are, the faster your car goes.
Okay.
So you could be in a group racing by typing the correct words. If you don't type it correctly, it doesn't go.
Okay.
So most times when I have a lot of kids in the lab, I put them on that. It helps them learn how to type and read.
Okay.
And follow instructions. So that's one. There's another one called Cool Math for Kids.
Okay.
It's got several categories and grades.
Okay.
In the Cool Math for Kids. So you can go in a racing game as well, but this time it's multiplication.
Okay.
It says 2 times 2. You type 4, the car moves.
Okay.
It gives you another equation, you tap the answer, and when you get it wrong, it stops. And everybody else is moving. So you gotta get the right answer to keep moving. So we do such things to not be in front of the kids. They like the computer, so you give them something to do on the computer that will impact upon their knowledge and ability.
Okay.
Those are the things we try to do. Because it's impossible to be with all the kids at the same time.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so we find nifty ways to keep them engaged educationally. While we help other people.
And they still, I mean, I'm sure they know, but at the same time, they probably don't realize how much they're actually learning.
They're not supposed to realize. Because when you first start it, it's usually punishment to them.
Oh, no.
Because they want to play what they want to play. But you force them to do this thing, and before they know it, they are better at typing.
Okay.
Well, I have somebody who brought back a grade. They scored 60 in key coding.
Okay.
This particular kid likes to play on the Roblox.
Okay.
That's a game that has nothing to do with education. It's entertainment.
Okay.
Now I force him to do the NitroType. His grades are improving.
Okay.
Because it's all about the keyboard.
So do you feel that, and I'm sure this is going to be a yes, but if parents would monitor, gauge, alternate mm-hmm. what their kids are playing,
mm-hmm.
not so much, and I don't know all the popular video games, but for every entertainment game,
mm-hmm.
you got to play this one educational
right. game. If most parents will enforce this. We don't have a choice but to have computers now, okay? So it's inevitable. Every home has a computer.
Yes.
Whether they have internet or not, they have a computer. So if you make it that the kid, for you to get on the computer, you stay on this game for 20 minutes. Mm-hmm. Nothing short of 20 minutes. After 20 minutes, I'll let you play some game. That's what I do.
Okay.
When they come in, if they don't read, I make them get on Nitro Type or Cool Mouth for Kids. For 20 minutes, then they could play whatever they want. But if that is, even that is limited, but the educational part first.
Okay.
So if we put first things first, we will improve the lives of our kids.
Yes.
And their education. If they always walk away with some kind of lesson, even if it's practice, you know what they say? Anything you practice for 40 days is permanent.
Okay.
So if you make them do this for 40 days, now they have a habit.
Okay.
Now they have a habit.
And then also to incorporate reading, mm-hmm. and this is one area that my son struggled with, the reading and comprehension. When he was doing spelling words,
mm-hmm.
If I read them aloud to him, he was able to give them back to me.
Mm-hmm.
But trying to read them on paper and trying to spell them or mm-hmm. write, like mm-hmm. he struggled. So I, as a parent, learned the very hard way how to help my child learn to the best of his abilities. Mm-hmm. I know a lot of teachers nowadays are facing frustrations
mm-hmm.
on the way they have to teach.
Yeah.
But this is where the parents and mentors and other people in kids' lives come in. Our kids need to learn 360 in a 360 environment. Like mm-hmm. every kid learns different, but they mm-hmm. still need to learn how to learn.
Right.
And
there's three ways to learn.
Okay.
Three ways to learn. There's visual, I see, and I learn. There's auditory, I hear, I learn. Then there's kinetic, I have to do to learn. So which one does your kid need? That's what we employ at the lab.
Okay.
They do, we show them, we talk to them. So they're exposed to all three.
Okay.
Then you find out which one learns best by how. How do they learn? Is it by you talking to them? Do they take cues or by them doing it?
And it's for those that are weaker in certain areas, you try to help strengthen those areas.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Amen.
All righty then. So we thank you so much for joining us today. Well,
thanks for having me. I didn't give you the phone number to the live.
No, you did not. Please go ahead and give us that.
All right. 277-1799.
1799. 1799.
277-1799.
And also go to their website.
Yep. NLEDC.org.
All right. And you also have a Facebook page.
So
send a message. Volunteer. Become
Please.
A mentor.
Help us.
Help,
okay. help us. To help our kids.
Who can't say that enough?
Thanks for having me.
Yes, sir. I hope that, you know, everyone that listened or watched the video, it takes something away from this name. You know, put on their calendar for next year to step up and be there for the kids that are
yep.
in need.
2020 is a great year for us.
All right.
We need all the volunteers. We need to make an impact in the city.
Yes.
One student at a time.
Yes. And we want to make this a great, better community.
Yes, ma'am.
Or better. We need to all do our part, do what we can, one day a week.
Amen.
That will make such an impact, more than you know. All right, so we're going to get out of here for today. We will be back on Monday.
All God right. bless you all.
Hope bless everyone you. Has a great and blessed day.
All right.
And try to stay dry through today.